Hey everybody, welcome to Creative Space. We're in Friendship, a neighborhood of Pittsburgh, at the Friendship Perk and Brew, and we're going to be speaking with its founder, Nick Redondo. So welcome to Creative Space. Let's learn about this new space, and we're going to shine a little light on it. Everybody, we are at the Friendship Perk and Brew in a wonderful, wonderful neighborhood of Pittsburgh called Friendship. And I'm here with the founder, Nick Redondo. Nick, this neighborhood, you have a long history with this neighborhood, right? I'm looking out the window right now at your childhood home right across the street here. Tell us about your connection with this historic neighborhood.
Well, my family moved here from the Hill District in 1959.
From the Hill District?
From the Hill in 1959. And I was 4 years old. And I just had great memories growing up here. I mean, as a kid, this side was a grocery store at one time. Okay. And it was run by a lady and her son. And it was the greatest place to grow up. We actually had two guys had horse and wagons. One was a rag man, and one was a fruit huckster. And they used to come around on horse and wagons, and we would run in the house and grab our fruit and carrots and celery and feed the horses. And they had a milkman who would just like get, we'd beg him for a piece of ice, because in those days it wasn't refrigeration, it was ice.
That's right.
You know, so we used to grab a piece of ice and we'd all smash it on the sidewalk and we'd all sit there and suck on it in the summertime. Like, so there was no like microband technology back then. We just took whatever germs we had and it was it, you know.
So you were born in...
I was born in the Hill.
In the Hill District of Pittsburgh, when you were four, you moved to this white house.
Right.
How long were you here in this little white house across from your...
Oh, God. I was here until 1984.
And
then I bought my house up the street one block up when the neighborhood was really bad at that point in time. Now it's a great neighborhood.
Yeah, so when you were a kid, what was the neighborhood like? Was it...
It was great. We didn't have ball fields to play in. We played in the alleys. We played football on the street right here. We just played between the cars.
Yeah.
When the cars were coming, then we'd go out and play. When the cars
didn't stop, you know. It was a safe neighborhood
at
that time.
Yeah, it was great. It was great to grow up here. It really was.
So flash forward, you say you bought a house in the 80s.
Right.
And at that time, the neighborhood was struggling a little bit. Talk about that.
I just got out of the Navy in 83, and I bought a house one block up the street, and it was three apartments, and it was a total wreck. But I got it for a good price, so I was going to fix it and keep it apartments. But then I met my wife, and then so we wanted to sign to stay there, and we fixed the house and brought it back to a single family, restored the old Victorian.
Yeah.
But it was rough back then. It was a really rough neighborhood. But things have happened since then, and you know, we had with the Walnut Capital buying the Bakery Square, and Google coming in, and Children's Hospital down here, and down the street down here is the. Is the Hillman Cancer Center.
Right.
I mean, this property, this neighborhood just really has changed. The whole neighborhood's changed. You have a whole different clientele of people in here.
So right. So the neighborhood's continuing to become more and more vibrant.
Yes.
And you have Shadyside on one side, you have Bloomfield on one side. It's very convenient.
It is.
Neighborhood.
It's everything.
Now, you're tucked away a little bit here, right?
Right.
And so all around us, we have pretty much homes. Okay, so let's just talk a little bit about your startup story here.
Okay.
What happened between when you bought your home in Friendship and starting this new Friendship Perk and Brew up? What happened with you career-wise in between?
Well, I was a pilot instructor for U.S. Air, and I trained pilots there for probably close to 20 years, I think, and about 20 years. When U.S. Air moved to Charlotte, I was reluctant to go because of the second bankruptcy, and I decided, well, let me do something else, and so I tried a couple other things, but then we weren't real happy with the tenant that was currently in here, so we decided to make a move and didn't renew the lease, and I went to the community, and I got all kind of input from the community. What is it you guys exactly want here? What do you want me to do with this place? It's a commercial property. So like this side was a store built probably sometime around the 20s, And the other side was actually the house built in the 1800s.
Okay, so there was a wall right here.
Right.
Okay, when a home and a little store.
Yeah.
Okay.
And when 7-Eleven came in, they broke through the walls of the house and combined the house and the store.
Okay.
And so, and right where we're sitting was a big walk-in cooler. This whole room was almost one giant walk-in cooler. And when we tore it out, we saw these beams and all the original beams, and it's all rough cut lumber. And we thought, oh, these are really cool. You know, I didn't realize they'd be good for acoustics too.
Yeah.
You know, so we pressure washed them and we took the plaster off the brick, and it just a lot of things in the whole development of this, a lot of it was luck. I mean, it really was.
So the year you started renovating this,
right?
It was
2016.
2016, and a lot of the renovation, you see the brick, and like you said, the exposed wood. You did this with your own two hands. You guys?
I didn't do it all. I mean, I did some things, but you know, we took the plaster off the brick, pressure washed. I took the mantelpiece was all beat up. My buddy gave it to me. It was all beat up, so I stripped it, refinished it, put it back together, and then we did. Like these pictures, all these photographs are all the neighborhood.
And yeah, all around you have photos. Where did you get those?
Well, I saw them online, and I ran into my neighbor one day, and I said, I found these photos. I didn't even know where she worked. We were just talking about it. And she said, well, that's where I work, the archives at Pitt. So I said, really? So she said, yeah. So I was able to buy the digital prints, and so I went to, and had them blown up and put on canvas. And I have a total of 35, but I've only blown up like about 11 so far. But yeah, I mean, it's the neighborhood like from 100 years ago.
Yeah,
you know,
really
this
cool.
is Morrow Park from 1920. You know, and people remember Babyland. That picture in the corner is Babyland over there, before when it was Schwartz's Sanitary Supermarket. You know, so it was Schwartz's.
And the fireplace, you added that yourself.
Yeah, that
right?
was actually an entrance when the house had a wraparound porch before they added the store. It was a wraparound porch, and it was an entrance to the dining room from the porch.
Okay.
You know, and when I was a kid, when this was a store, that was actually, you'd go up, and that was the room people were allowed to drink beer.
Okay.
So they had a beer license here since after Prohibition.
Okay, you know, wow.
So it's been a long time.
It's been a long time you've had a beer license here.
Yeah.
So everybody told you they wanted a coffee shop, Perk and Brew. You started to think about, okay, what should this be exactly? So what was the concept? Because it's more than coffee. You have beer, you have breakfast and lunch, and tell everybody about what it is today. What are your hours? What kind of things do you do here now?
Well, when we had to go get our variance for the city, the one thing that I really wanted in a shop, I wanted a place where people, when they leave, they feel better for having spent time here. That's really what I wanted. That's really what I want. I mean, obviously, I'm a capitalist. I need to make money to keep my doors open to support my family. But by the same token, I wanted people to come in here. I want them to feel good when they leave. I want them to feel like they had a good experience. The food was good. The atmosphere was good. And that's really what I was shooting for, you know. And so that's kind of how we, you know, approached this whole thing. When we first opened, we were opening like at 6 o'clock in the morning and staying open until 10. And that just wasn't doing it, you know.
Right, right. It's a long time.
We were putting some long days in. And so we just actually cut the hours to 7 a.m. to 8 p.m.
Okay.
Some of the things we do now is...
Are you doing that 7 days a week, 7 a.m.?
Six. We're closed on Mondays. We're open Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then Friday and Saturday, and then Sunday from 9 to 2 for brunch.
Okay, Sunday's a little bit of a shorter day, and you have Mondays off.
Right.
But otherwise...
But I'm here on Mondays anyway.
And you guys are having breakfast, you have lunch, you have dinner.
We don't have dinner entrees per se. We basically have our menu that's just like sandwiches, soups and salads, pastries, appetizers.
Yeah, you know. And the beer selection, you have various beers here.
Right.
Well, what would you point out if somebody was to say... do you have something that's especially good on the food side, on the drink side?
We have a left-hand milk stout, which is nitro beer. We try to have better beers. We have like Trogues, East End Brewery type beers. Then we also have like a Yingling and beers. Like people, not everybody wants a craft beer. We first thought we would just have only craft, and we did.
Right.
But I come to find out that people really didn't want just all craft beers.
Right.
So we decided to like just... We don't have a giant selection of beers, but we have a selection of good beers.
Right.
You know.
So you were renovating in 2016. Mm-hmm. You first opened the doors of Friendship Perk and Brew.
September 17th of 2017.
September.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're just about 2 years old. You just had your 2 year anniversary. Yeah. And I see a sign up there.
It's my favorite saying. Yeah, it says attitude is everything. It's all about attitude.
Tell us about that, where the sign's from, why you put that up there.
One thing that I've come to realize about life, I saw a lot of things, especially in the military. I was part of the expedition with the Navy. We brought the Marines there from the 24th Marine Amphibious Unit back in Beirut in 1983, when a lot of those guys had gotten killed in a terrorist bombing. And you come to realize, when you see something like that, how short and tenuous life is.
Yeah.
And you've got to learn to appreciate every day, because every day is a blessing and a gift. And you have two options in life. You can either complain about it or get on with it. That's it. That's all you got. That's my whole approach to life. And so it's your attitude. You can choose your attitude. That's the only thing we have a choice about, is what we think and how we feel. That's the only thing we have.
Yeah.
That's the only control we have of anything. So that's always been my since that period in my life. I've adopted that philosophy, and it's served me well.
Yeah. And I can tell you, when I first came here, and we reconnected, because we had known each other years ago.
Back in 2005, I think I met you, yeah.
Yeah, and yeah. When I came here, I did feel better when I left, in part because I had a chocolate chip muffins, which is super good, and the pancakes here and the breakfast are wonderful. But it was a special friend of ours who reconnected us.
Right, Sue Wagner,
Sue Wagner, who is just a genius artist. And
she's as humble
sculptor.
As she is talented.
It's
yes.
So good to see you. And
good to see you too.
Nick and I were just talking a little bit about you, your wonderful career as a sculptor and an artist here. But you've been in this community for how long?
35 years.
35 years in Friendship.
Yes.
You have a beautiful home studio,
yeah,
right?
I do.
When did you meet Nick?
I don't remember, just walking around the neighborhood. So I love to walk around.
From and, just being here together and living here in
and
the neighborhood.
I knew his father first.
Okay.
And his father I was thrilled to be able to walk to a store, and his father would be out raking leaves or something. He was always such a gentleman. Didn't know me, but had the nicest smile. He said, "Hello, how are you today?" Just a nicety. And then I found out that was Nick's father. So I knew Nick was a good guy just from that.
Yeah. So when Nick started this up just 2 years ago, what did you think? What were you hearing in the community?
Well,
what were you expecting?
Some people were against it, and some people wanted it.
Okay.
I'd say, Nick, it's going to happen. I believe in you. It's going to be great. I always wanted him to know that, and he did it. He made it even better than I thought.
So he exceeded your expectations.
Yes, he did.
And you think the community is now thrilled?
I think the community likes it.
Yeah.
Because it's so homey here.
It is.
And his workers are wonderful. And it feels like you're walking in to Nick's living room.
Right.
And Nick talks to you and makes you feel welcome. And the food is so good. And if I feel like being with people, I know where to go.
Right. When did you start talking with Nick about the music, the live music?
We were talking about our favorite kinds of music, and Nick said, "Susan, I really love jazz." And I said, "Me too." So then I'm driving around with you, and I know how you help entrepreneurs, and I knew Nick needed to get the word out. And then something just popped into my head, ask Jess. So I did, and that's all I did. And then and then you and Nick put a wonderful program together.
Yeah, there's so many great musicians in our region.
Oh, there is.
Singers, musicians in jazz and in other American genres who would love to play here. And I think it's interesting that when you walk in, this little area on your right-hand side, it just becomes a perfect little stage, doesn't it?
I know, it does.
And what do you think about having an outdoor venue?
I can't wait.
Yeah.
I can't wait.
Having some live music on a deck.
That'll really bring it. You can open your window and hear music, or come here and hear music, and it's
lovely.
Would be just a wonderful thing. Yeah.
Okay, and last thing, art, visual art.
Okay.
So he has these pretty cool photographs hanging all around and of the neighborhood, right? And tell us a little bit just what you think about these photographs, what they mean to you, you know, the neighborhood as it's gone through its ups and downs over time, and a little bit about visual art in the community here, just what's happening on the...
Okay. When we first moved in, the whole neighborhood was a wreck. And I saw the beauty in the house, you know, and I was painting the outside of the house, and I thought I was the only one that really appreciated this architecture. And about 10 years later, I'm walking down the street, and I notice somebody else painting the outside of the house. But yeah, other people are seeing this. Now, we have artists and architects and musicians coming into this neighborhood, young families. They're realizing this is a beautiful, beautiful, friendly neighborhood with amazing architecture, old architecture that stands the test of time, and you just can't get it anymore. And people are realizing they can renovate a house but still keep the old charm. And then seeing these photographs, I don't remember. This was way before my time.
These are 100 years.
Yeah.
You can see
way
how the community's changed.
It's really changed.
And there are spots, places all around this neighborhood where visual art is presented as well, right? You've presented visual art in some of the smaller venues in Penn Avenue,
right,
and different places. So very friendly for artists and musicians and creatives.
They're just flocking in. There's many galleries on Penn Avenue.
Yeah.
There is one on Liberty in Bloomfield that's a great gallery.
Yeah.
And it's just a wonderful, very eclectic mix.
Right.
Of people and art.
Yeah.
You know, which is wonderful.
Well, on behalf of the community, not only the Friendship community, the larger Pittsburgh region community, the community of creatives, the musicians, and I just want to thank you for being such a terrific connector and supporter. And I wouldn't be here if it weren't for you, and we wouldn't be shining a light on this creative space.
How the universe works.
Yeah.
It just works the way it's supposed to, I think.
Thank you, Susan.
Okay, you're welcome. Yeah. Thank you.
All right. How long have you known Susan? And she's been living in this neighborhood for over 30 years.
Yeah.
When did you first get to know Susan?
It was probably about at least 25 years.
You know, okay.
She lives over on Aiken Avenue, which just a block and a half over from me.
Right.
You know. So yeah. So I've known Sue for quite some time. You know.
Yeah.
And she's just as kind and decent a woman as you'd ever want to meet, and a good soul. She has a good heart. And, you know. She, like I said, she's so humble. She's so talented, but you would never know it's her. I mean, it's funny because she says she likes to stand by the statue of Clemente and listen to people's comments.
Right. Oh, you know? She sculpted the Roberto Clemente
at the State PNC Park.
PNC Park.
Clemente, Stargell, Mazeroski.
Yeah.
She did those three. She did Tom Starzl. She did the 14th Quartermaster. You know, she did Rocco the Dog. I mean, she's exceedingly talented.
And so from her home, she can walk here.
Yeah. Yep.
And so she was bragging about this place to me and saying, hey, I think in the future there might be a room for some jazz there, right? So let's talk about, over the last 2 years, your startup. What's been good about your startup here and what's been challenging about the 2 years that you've been here?
You know, when we first started, we made it. I said I tried to get as much input from the neighbors as I could. And I observed a lot too. We have a fountain outside. There's three fountains in one. One's for people walk dogs all the time. So we have a dog fountain. We have we're on a bike lane. So we had a fountain for people riding their bicycles to fill their water bottles, and a regular drinking fountain people to walk by. But we made a lot of assumptions. And the reality is, I was a pilot instructor. I wasn't a restaurateur. You know, but I figured, what the heck? If you don't take a risk in life, you're never going to live it. You know.
That's right.
So we took a risk, and you know, we made some people might want this or that, and then we decided, and we come out and find what people really want. You know, and we listen to people, what they really want. You know, we do our best. We can't be all things to all people as much as we'd like to be. We just can't. You know, but we do our best to make as many people happy as we can. And so, you know, the important thing is the quality of the food we buy. Just some of the best stuff going. I mean, we buy the best meats, the best cheeses, the best. We use Dallallo Foods, Reinhardt. You know, there's a lot of like high-end stuff we use.
And local.
Local, yes, yeah. Like okay. Our coffee is my buddy, is best buddy, is Ed Wethley. It owns Kiva Hunt Coffee in Crazy Mocha.
Yeah.
You know, and Ed and I met. It was kind of funny how we met. We were at a kids' basketball game in the summer league, you know, and we're sitting in the bleachers wearing the same pair of sandals, same kind of sandals. And I made a joke and said, yo, for a guy, you have good taste in shoes. And we just kind of hit it off. And it turns out that he was right around the corner from my property in Cranberry that I owned. And I called him up one day, and we got together and had lunch, and we hit it off. And we've been best buddies ever since. You know, so he's a great guy. Ed does a lot of humanitarian stuff. He's a good man. He really does. He started the Ananias Mission, which was to take Syrian Christians that were being slaughtered out of Syria and bring them here actually brought them to the Catholic Church through Canada.
Wow.
You know, so he does a lot of good stuff. And so Ed helped me here, and he was my advisor on the coffee side of it, and he roasts all our coffee, so our coffee's roasted locally. And what I like about it, he actually goes to the villages where they grow the coffee, okay. meets the people, wow. and helps the people with, like, things they need in their village, whether it's computers, whether it's scales, whether it's anything that these people need, because he realizes how hard these people work.
And so you started to do some live music here. During the time that you've started up, you've played off and on, right? You've had some live music here and some creative events. Yeah. Talk about that.
Well, because we had kind of an out-of-way location, we're not mm-hmm. like really on a main avenue like Liberty Avenue or
right.
Penn Avenue, where
right.
you know if we were in the Strip or we were on Fifth Avenue or Forbes Avenue in Oakland, so we're kind of an out-of-the-way place. And so it's hard to get people to come notice us.
You're close to a lot of big streets,
right.
but you're tucked away in the neighborhood, just
corner,
a couple
yeah.
streets over.
We're tucked away in a little corner.
Yeah.
But so I'm thinking, how can I get people in, or what do I need to do to attract people? You know. And so we have a Tuesday lecture series,
okay.
where we have different topics. Like, people that may have a small business may come in and be able to talk about their service business or their business, you know, whether it's a chiropractor or a guy who's a corporate headhunter,
yeah.
you know, and so they talk about things that, you know, about their business and how they can help people.
Yeah.
The customers come in, you know, they learn something, and then they buy something from us, so it's kind of win for everybody.
Right.
You know, so that's one way. Then we do indoor bocce in the winter.
Okay.
We have a separate bocce court right here, bocce thing right across here, which
okay.
is kind of fun. People see indoor bocce, people go, how do you do that? But I thought, you know, music would be kind of cool, and so... I always loved jazz, and I really wanted more of a jazz venue.
Right.
But we've had a lot of local artists who would come and approach me and say, do you mind if I play? Some neighbors.
Yeah.
And so I said, okay. So they came to play, and people liked it. And then we have a bluegrass group that comes, and they'll play on a Saturday afternoon. And it's a whole different. It's like folk music. It's bluegrass, and sometimes it's rock. But you know, now with your help, we're going to start doing more jazz. After the first of January.
Yeah. So in the new year, 2020, it's hard to believe 2020 already. We're talking about, but first and third Saturdays, Nick, you're looking to do some jazz
right.
Programming, and the happy hour slot.
Right.
A couple places in this venue where you've done music, right in front of us, where we're sitting in this main window. This is kind of a nice little stage nook here,
yeah.
and this has been beautiful, right? And you've also done some live music in the back of
yeah.
the room.
I'll let the artists decide where they want to set up.
As well,
yeah.
yeah. And I can tell you, so I had the great joy of playing here not too long ago and trying this venue out, and what's amazing is it's great for sound.
Yeah.
So did you think about that?
No, was luck.
Okay.
There was a lot of luck in this whole thing, I'm telling you. Like,
okay.
My affiliation with Ed and Kiva Hahn,
yeah.
you know, these photographs,
yeah.
the tearing out, the walking corner and finding these beams,
yeah.
you know, the plaster, just chipping the plaster off the bricks. So there was a lot of things, like, you know, in our manager, Diane, and Marianne, who has been with Diane since we opened. You know, I mean, they're we just got lucky on a lot of things.
You have wonderful people. And
I do.
And talking about your people for a second, your chef, you want to say a couple of words about who's
we have, you know,
creating your food?
For the longest time, well, my sister, Joanne, really, she's the one that likes to do, she loves food. She's a foodie, and she's really good at it. And she works with the cooks in the back, you know, and they come up with ideas. And so we're always looking for new ideas.
Okay.
You know, and so we try to come up with new and different things, you know, the from the product that we actually are using already, you know. because in this business you just can't keep buying everything, as you know.
Right,
you know.
Right.
But
yeah,
but but yeah, our cooks do a wonderful job. They really do, and we're, like I said, I'm so blessed and so lucky to have what we have. I mean,
yeah,
we really do. I mean, it took us a while to find the cooks that will actually come to work and do the job.
Right.
You know, but we finally got that, and they got really good people, and it makes life so much easier.
Finding,
you know,
the right people, that's right. A couple of things about this space. The windows are magnificent. You have a lot of natural light.
Right.
Today it's a little bit of a cloudy day, and it's still nice and bright in here. You have a vision, though, for the front of this space. So tell us about your vision for a renovation out in the front here for the summer or so.
We don't really have outdoor seating, and that's what people really want, is outdoor seating. So I want to put a deck right out front here across the front lawn, put a nice deck. I have a beautiful Italian marble fountain to go out to. It's gorgeous. You know, make it a Victorian style deck with some nice potted trees, and just make it like a really warm and comfortable place where you'd like to be.
The neighborhood now, when you look around, it seems like everything is becoming more and more vibrant.
Yeah.
And I know just recently some young musicians moved into this neighborhood. And how has the neighborhood reacted to your being here and the Perk and Brew concept?
When we first started, I had a lot of support from the community. There was a few people who were concerned about us doing this, because I think they thought it might have been a bar we were going to turn into, like a, you know,
more about the beer,
right?
Okay.
Yeah, and we didn't.
Yeah,
and actually, some of the people who were originally concerned now are on board as well. I mean, I haven't had, they come in, they patronize us, you know, and they like being here too.
So the neighborhood's been good, and I know I've been here on Saturday mornings, and I've seen like a bunch of marathon runner types.
Right. Yeah, they
always
in.
Coming in here.
Yeah, they come in the morning and get their coffee.
Yeah,
you know, and then,
yeah,
and then
you have regulars.
Their workouts. Yeah,
you have,
their
yeah,
workouts, and then they'll come back after their workouts and they'll come in and have breakfast.
They're
wonderful folks. They really are.
Yeah.
They're just wonderful. It's nice because you've got these people that like, or you know, they enjoy being here. You get to know them after a while. You know, you get to kid around with them, and they kid around with you. And it is just nice. It's like it's what a community is.
Right.
You know, it really is.
Right.
You know, people know each other and can communicate with each other and have a nice time.
That's right. And you and I have a love for live music, love for jazz.
Yes.
And that's the common language.
Right.
Music brings all of us together, young to old. And so in 2020, we're going to be seeing more live music programming
right
here. I think I'm going to be here with Mark Strickland, the great guitarist, the first Saturday in January. We're going to kick off, right? You're going to be doing first and third, kind of happy hour, 5
right
to 7:30-ish.
Right. Right.
Happy hour music. You have the beer, you have food and drink.
And on Friday nights, we also have trivia, too.
And Fridays,
second and fourth Friday of the month, we do trivia.
Okay, so you're going to be doing lectures, you're going to be doing live music, you're going to be doing trivia, you're doing all
indoor
kinds.
Indoor bocce.
Who else has that? Right. Okay, and I'm guessing you are open to community suggestions as well. If people
want
to come in and try some programming.
Tell me people like, it's funny, I get calls from so many different people, like just different artists, you know, the some do country. You know, they were some of the funniest guys going, some of the country guys. We had a good time, you know.
Sense of humor.
Yeah, they were. They were funny guys. They were good guys, you know.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, since I've opened these, I've met so many good people. I really have. And that's the nice thing about it. I've just met so many good people. I feel blessed to be able to be here. I really do. You know, it was a dream, a lifelong dream, something I wanted to do. I didn't build skyscrapers like, you know, Donald Trump or some big real estate developer, but you know, this was my little dream.
That's exactly right. You know. Hey, everybody, thank you so much for tuning in today. Please come on down and check out the Friendship Perk and Brew, this wonderful creative space. We thank Nick Redondo, Susan Wagner, and really all the great people who have been supporting this relatively new venue. Glad to shine a light on it. Come on down and check it out for yourselves. Try the chocolate chip muffin.